It is a continuation of B19 virus, parvovirus. It causes following clinical syndromes, that is flu-like illness, erythema infectiosum or FIP disease, infection in pregnant women, and chronic B19 infection. The flu-like illness, the presentation is malaise, headache, myalgia, and rhinorrhea. In erythema infectiosum or FIP disease, this condition is common in children, and there is non-specific symptoms followed by appearance of typical distinctive rash which appears on 5th day of the infection. In this you will find a bright red rash which develops on both the cheeks and it appears as if they have been slapped. So there is slap cheek rash. It is the typical presentation of the 5th disease. This rash appears on the trunk which spreads later towards the arm and legs. The condition is it subsides within 1 to 2 weeks. This can also cause aplastic anemia, which can be transient, but in some cases it can also cause severe aplastic anemia, and especially in children with chronic anemia such as sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, spherocytosis can occur with infection with B19 virus. Important serious complication which occurs with this syndrome is there can be gloves and socks syndrome. In this syndrome, what happens? There is erythematous exanthema which appears on hands and feet with a well-defined margin on wrist and ankle joints. So in this picture, you can appreciate there is a exanthematous rash over the hands and over the feet. And there is a well-defined margin over the wrist and at the ankle, giving the appearance of gloves and sock syndrome. The next clinical syndrome, infection in pregnant women. If the B19 virus causes reinfection in a pregnant mother who is infected earlier by the same virus and is already immune to the virus, already exposed to the same virus, then there would be antibodies against the virus, B19 antibodies. And here there would be no adverse effects to the fetus. But if the pregnant mother is seronegative and non-immune to B19 virus, then there is a associated increased risk to fetus and it can cause fetal death and hydrops fetalis. And the infection may cause severe anemia in the fetus and there may be signs of high output cardiac failure. But this infection does not cause any congenital anomalies in the fetus. Chronic B19 infection. This type of infection occurs in immunocompromised patients who are infected with HIV or who are under immunosuppressive therapy for a longer time and transplant recipient patient. In these, there would be chronic anemia, leukopenia and thrombocytopenia, because of massive destruction of the RBCs. Transmission, the infected patient is contagious from 24 to 48 hours before developing prodromal syndrome till the appearance of rash. And the infection is transmitted by the route of transmission can be vertical from mother to child during birth and then respiratory route through respiratory secretion. Another important source of transmission can be percutaneous exposure to blood and transfusion of blood and blood products like pooled RBCs, platelets and IV immunoglobulins. Lab diagnosis, the demonstration of specific antibodies, that is IgG and IgM antibodies in the serum are useful in diagnosing erythema infectiosum. Their IgG antibodies indicate past infection or past exposure, and IgM antibodies indicate the recent infection. ELISA, RIA, and indirect fluorescent antibody tests can be done for this virus. In pregnant women, if the serum is positive for both IgG and IgM antibodies, this indicates B19 virus infection within 7 days to 14 to 4 months. And there is a possible risk to fetus. But if it is only positive for seropositive only for immunoglobulin G but negative for IgM, this results indicate only past infection and there is no risk to the fetus. Molecular methods like PCR can be done to demonstrate virus genome in the blood, and the positive results suggest viremia or infection. Treatment: there is no specific antiviral therapy available for the treatment of P19 virus infection. And prevention and control: there are no specific measures available for prevention of this infection. And vaccine is undergoing phase 1 clinical trial and under development process. Next important virus is HPV, that is human papilloma virus. This belongs to family Papillomavidae, and it has 16 genera, and human papilloma virus is one of them, important genus which infects the man. Human papilloma virus is most commonly transmitted sexually. Structure: it is small non-enveloped icosahedral DNA virus which has a diameter of 52 to 55 nanometer. It is single double-stranded DNA molecule of about 8000 base pair that is bound to cellular histones. It has protein capsid with 72 pentameric capsomeres, and capsid, it contains of two structure protein, that is late 1 and late 2, L1 and L2 proteins, and these are code for structural proteins. L1 code for capsid major proteins and L2 code for minor capsid proteins, and both are virally encoded. And apart from this, we have early region also, and E genes, basically they code for non-structural protein, and there are around E1 to E7 proteins or genes which code for non-structural protein, and they are responsible for viral replication. The International Committee on the Taxonomy of Viruses has categorized this into two separate families, that is Papillomavidae and Polyomavidae. Now Papillomavidae is a family to which human papillomavirus belongs, and the HPV is further has been divided into high risk HPV and low risk HPV. Basically, low risk HPV or types, they cause warts and benign lesion, and high risk types can cause malignant lesions or cancer. Pathogenesis: the human papillomavirus, they have selective tropism for the epithelium of skin and mucous membrane, and it can cause the infection is limited to basal cells of stratified epithelium. The virus cannot bind to the live tissue, and how it gains the entry to the basement membrane, it infects the epithelial tissue through microabrasions or other epithelial trauma which exposes the segments of the basement membrane. And when it is exposed or gain access to the basement membrane, HPV virion, it associates with the receptor present on the basement membrane, such as alpha integrins, laminins, and annexin A2. So basically, it has selective tropism for the epithelium of skin and mucous membrane, and it gain access to the basement membrane through the microabrasions or epithelial trauma. And then there, when it gains access to it, it binds to the receptors and cause infection. Now how this basically human papilloma virus, it causes cancer. So it has early proteins which are from A1 to E7, but in causing cancer, E6 and E7 proteins have the major role, and they inactivate two important tumor suppressor proteins, that is P53 which is inactivated by E6, and retinoblastoma protein which is inactivated by the E7. So what happens basically, the virus infects the epithelial cell, and then the E7, it inhibits the protein of retinoblastoma, which is the tumor suppressor protein. And when it suppresses, it causes the dysregulation of the cellular proliferation. Normally what happens when this is not inhibited, Because of this tumor suppressor gene, what will happen? This will cause apoptosis induction, and there would be elimination of the infection or removal of the infection. There would be lysis of the virus, and there would be elimination. But what happens when this is inhibited, E7, it causes dysregulation of the cellular proliferation. Another important protein, which is E6, it blocks the this production or induction of apoptosis. And this causes p53 degradation, which is another tumor suppressor gene or protein, and this leads to uncontrolled outgrowth of dysregulated cells. So there is lot of highly replicating and at fastly replicating and uncontrolled uncontrolled manner they are replicating, dividing, and there is outgrowth of dysregulated cells. There is high level of mutation happening in these cells, and these are called cancerous cells. Coming to symptoms, these human papillomavirus may not cause any symptoms at once, and they may appear very late, maybe after many years, and sometimes can lead to warts formation, and the others can cause cancer. So one of the important presentation is warts. Now these warts can be skin warts or genital warts. Genital warts may appear as small bumps, cluster of bumps or stem-like protrusion, and they commonly affect the vulva in women or possibly the cervix and the penis or scrotum in men. They may also appear around the anus and in the groin. The appearance of this wart can range in size and appearance, and can be small, can be large, flat or cauliflower shaped, and the color or tone can be white or flesh tone. The low risk type, that is HPV 6 and 11, they are common cause of genital warts and laryngeal papillomatosis. These are basically cause, most of the infection or route of transmission is sexually only, but orogenital practices can also lead to these type of infection. These are the various presentation of the warts, where you can see the raised surface of the warts. They can be cauliflower like, they can be cristate like, they can be papular, mushroom shaped, papillary, and then irregular. Warts can be common warts, plantar warts, and flat warts. Now, common warts, they are rough raised bumps, most commonly found on the hands, fingers, and elbows. And plantar warts, they are described as hard, grainy growth on the feet, and they most commonly appear on the heels or balls of the feet. Flat warts, generally, they are seen in children, adolescents, and young adults, where they appear as flat, topped, slightly raised lesions that are darker than the normal skin color, and most commonly found on the face, neck, or areas that have been scratched. So you can see the warts over the hand. They can be also presentation of anogenital warts. Then they can be anal dysplasia. These are the precancerous conditions seen in anal canal. They can be genital cancer, they can be epidermodysplasia variceifolmis, which is also known as Treeman syndrome, or high-risk skin cancer. Basically, this is a rare autosomal recessive benign condition, which may progress to squamous cell malignancy, and the malignant transformation occurs when it is infected with unique human papilloma virus types 5 and 8. This is more common when the areas which are more sun exposed. Then is focal epithelial hyperplasia. This is benign neoplasmic condition in mouth. And laryngeal papillomas, mouth papillomas, these are benign epithelial tumor. Oropharyngeal cancer, laryngeal papillomatosis, this is aerodigestive benign cancer. So these are the other presentation of the human papillomavirus infections. Apart from this, the cancer, the human papilloma virus has increased risk of developing cancer, and it can cause a cancer of cervix, vulva, vagina, penis, anus, oropharynx or base of tongue and tonsils. It may, however, take years or decades for the cancer to develop. And early all cervical cancer is due to human papilloma virus with two types, that is HPV 16 and 18. So these are high risk types. 16 and 18 are high risk type, which account for 70% of the cases which cause the cancer, cervical cancer. These cancers are common and involve the sexual transmission, and the individual which are infected with both HPV and HIV, they have higher risk of developing cervical and anal cancer. Transmission is through intimate skin to skin contact, having vaginal, anal or oral sex with someone who is infected. It is most commonly spread during vaginal or anal sex. It is commonly, nearly all men and women, they get infected at some point in their life. This can be passed even when the infected person has no signs or symptoms. So asymptomatic person is also infectious. They can develop symptoms years after being infected, and making it very hard to know when the person got first infected. And most of the time, these infection does not cause any health problem, but when it does not resolve, it does not go away, it can cause health problems, which can be genital warts or it can lead to cancer. Diagnosis. For the diagnosis, traditional methods are not useful, like electron microscopy, cell culture, certain immunological methods. They are not suitable for HPV detection, and the HPV cannot be cultured in cell cultures also. The most important method to diagnose human papillomavirus infection is colposcopic and acetic acid tests, biopsy, DNA tests like PCR, southern blot hybridization, in situ hybridization and pap smear. Now, what is colposcopy? Colposcopy is a procedure which allows illuminated stereoscopic view, which is magnified view of the cervix, and you can see the changes within the cervix. PCR methods, molecular methods include which amplify the human papillomavirus DNA. It's useful. Biopsy, it shows the any changes, pre-cancer, dysplasia or cancerous changes, and if there are, then treatment is recommended. The dysplasia can be mild, moderate or severe, and you can do the histopathology and cytology can be done for the human papillomavirus infection. Then is pap smear or pap test. It is a screening test, and apart from pre-malignant and malignant changes, which you can see here, it also detects the herpes virus along with the human papilloma virus. Then is acetic acid test. The acetic acid solution is applied to the human papilloma virus infected genital areas, which then turn white. This basically helps in making the lesion more visible, which are difficult to see, especially the flat lesions. Pap smear test is early precancerous changes can be detected on pap smear, and women who may have cervical cancer and do not know it because she may not have any symptoms. So asymptomatic women may have cervical cancer but not present any symptoms. So it's very useful in that case to diagnose or detect the early precancerous changes. Pap smear is usually a part of pelvic examination and is accompanied by breast examination. And here a sample of mucus and cells is obtained from the cervix and endocervix using a wooden scraper or a small cervical brush or broom. Then this sample is rinsed into a vial and sent to laboratory for slide preparation and examination. Treatment. Currently, there is no specific treatment for human papillomavirus infection. However, the warts, they can be treated. For this, we can salicyclic acid can be applied. This is over the counter treatment is available, and salicylic acid, it works by removing the layers of wart, and then it's imiquimod. This prescription cream is enhance your immune system ability to fight human papilloma virus. So basically it is interferon inducer. Sometimes it can cause redness and swelling at the application site. Then is podophyllox or condylox. It is another topical prescription, and it works by destroying the genital wart tissue. It may cause pain and itching topically. Then is trichloroacetic acid. This is a chemical treatment which burns off the warts present on the palm, soles and genital. It might cause local irritation. Treatment. Surgical and other procedures can be done if the medication does not work, and following methods can be used to remove warts like cryotherapy, electrocautery, surgical remover and laser surgery. For the prevention or to reduce the risk of this infection, barrier methods are useful and it blocks the transmission. Then is vaccination. The three vaccines are available to prevent infection by some human papillomavirus types, and all protects against the initial infection with human papillomavirus type 16 and 18, which are high risk types and mostly associated with cancer. Gardasil is a quadrivalent vaccine, so it protects against both the low risk type and high risk type, that is 6, 11, 16 and 18, which causes 90% of the genital warts. It's a quadrivalent vaccine, and this is given in 3 doses. 0.5 ml is given subcutaneously, and this is given at the interval of 0 at 2 months and then 6 months. The age which is important for this is 9 to 26 years of age to which it can be given. Second is Cervarix. Cervarix is a bivalent vaccine, and it is prepared from virus-like particles of L1 capsid protein. It is active against the low-risk type, 6 and 11. Then is Gardasil 9. This is another version of Gardasil. It is non-avalent, and it has the potential to prevent about 90% of all the cancers, cervical, vulvar, vaginal and anal. So what it is doing, basically it is protecting not against all these, the above four of the Gardasil, but also the additional which are also important types which can cause the cancer, like 31, 33, 45, 52 and 58. So it is the additional protection to these types. So these are the vaccinations which can be given for prevention. That's all.